وهل أتاك حديث موسى إذ رأى نارا فقال لأهلهم كثوا إني آنست نارا لعلي آتيكم منها بقبس أو أجد على النار هدى.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ويسألونك عن الجبال فقل ينسفها ربي نسفا فيذرها قاعا صفصفا لا ترى فيها عوجا ولا أمتا صدق الله العظيم. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing the intensity, the severity and the horror of the day of Qiyamah. And we were discussing how the occupants of hell will realize that they stay on earth or their combined stay on earth and the grave was very, very short. And fortunate indeed are those who can capitalize on this transitory abode and this brief stay on earth and earn an eternal Jannah. And most wretched and unfortunate are those who abuse and exploit this time and make it as the ultimate, which Abu Darda radiallahu anhu said, Inna khayra sahibikum, your best companion is one who says, Ta'al, come, nasum qabla an namut, let us observe the fast before death overpowers us. And your worst friend is the one that says, نَأْكُلْ وَنَشْرَبْ وَنَلْهُ قَبْلَ أَن نَمُودْ, that let us eat, let us merrymake, let us party, let us indulge before death overpowers us. In the 22nd juz in Surah Fatir, Allah says, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ, did we not bless you with a life adequate enough for the one who intended to take heed and reflection, that there was enough time for him to take heed and reflection. أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ, did we not give you a life, ma, in which يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ, the one who wanted to benefit could have well benefited. And we see in our temporary life, as short and as brief as it is, how we set worldly goals and targets and we achieve it. People have these goals and they work on it diligently and relentlessly and tirelessly and indefatigably, and they achieve it, right? Why not apply that same principle, if not on a greater level, towards Akhirah, because that's the ultimate place. So in this verse 105, as we mentioned, that now the tale and the narrative and the story of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam has been concluded, and the remaining verses speak about Ma'ad, about Hisab, about Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, etc., etc. So, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ فَقُلْ يَنْسِفُهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا. And they ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, regarding the mountains, what will happen to the mountains on the day of Qiyamah? So the mountains is one of the more larger creations of the Almighty visible to man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the mountains, وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادَا, وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادَا. And the mountains are like pegs on the earth, pegs to keep the earth firm and fixed, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ, and they ask you regarding the mountains. You know, I'm reminded of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he speaks about an evil quality, that إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ بِجَبَلٍ زَالَ عَنْ مَكَانِهِ فَصَدِّقُوهُ. If a person comes and tells you that a mountain has moved, tell him, I accept your verdict and I believe what you say. But if somebody comes and tells you that a man has given up an evil trait and abandoned a bad quality, then don't accept that claim of his. Meaning that, as they say in English, old habits die hard. The abandoning of an evil habit is a very, very difficult thing. I often say, to give up an evil habit is difficult but possible. So when people say it's impossible, we argue contrary with that. It's possible. And if somebody says, well, it's difficult, well, nobody said it's easy. Nobody said it's easy. That is why I often say it's easier to resist the temptation of vice, as difficult as it is, it's easier to resist the temptation of vice than to succumb to it and then try and wean yourself off it. So somebody is tempting you, enticing you, and you find this is irresistible, it's extremely difficult. And I cannot deny, it's challenging, it's daunting, it's attractive, it's seductive. The environment, the people around you, you're a young man, you're going through, your hormones are turning and evolving, and all this is happening. It's challenging. But it is easier to desist and to back off than to succumb to this evil, and then you try and wean yourself off subsequently. Every time you succumb to the vice, you get a temporary relief, but the evil gets a tighter grip around you. And that's what is all addiction about, right? My honorable dad says, and may Allah preserve him with goodness and afia, that the world has become so addicted that the tobacco industry can boldly print the harms of tobacco without fearing a drop in sales. So people will have a billboard, and in that, they'll advertise their product and they will say it causes cancer, not good for pregnant women, it pollutes the environment, which is a negative to the advert itself. And a person will walk in a shop and say, you know what, sir, can I have a carton or can I have a box of cigarettes? Yes, precisely the one that causes cancer. Exactly, that's the one I'm looking for. That's the one I'm looking for. So why we've become so addicted? We've become so addicted, unfortunately, that it has obscured our lenses. It has barred our vision. May Allah protect us. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ بِجَبَلٍ زَالَ عَنْ مَكَانِهِ إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ بِجَبَلٍ زَالَ عَنْ مَكَانِهِ فَصَدِّقُوهُ. And that's the nature of the ego. The more you give it, the more it becomes accustomed to it. And then, you know what, I need access to this, then only I can eat. I need access to a particular washroom, loo or toilet, then only I could relieve myself, etc. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ فَقُلْ يَنْسِفُهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا. So, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you regarding these huge, amazing mountains around you. Allah has used mountains in the Quran in different contexts, as I've just mentioned here, وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse, وَإِنْ كَانَ مَكْرُهُمْ لِتَزُولَ مِنْهُ الْجِبَالِ وَإِنْ كَانَ مَكْرُهُمْ قَدْ مَكَرُوا مَكْرًا. In the 13th juz in Surah Al-Ra'd, Allah says that, these people had plotted, they had plotted, and their plots were so mighty that they could actually move mountains through their plots. But of course, when it comes to the ultimate will of the Almighty, Allah dismantles their plots and Allah overpowers their plots, and it has no clout or meaning in the eyes of the Almighty. So وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ, say unto them, فَقُلْ يَنْسِفُهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا. نَسَفَ يَنْسِفُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shatter them into dust. As huge as these mountains are, Allah will just shatter them into dust. I often mentioned this year, some time back I was flying in East Africa, and we were taking a domestic hop from internally from Mombasa to Nairobi, and en route, whenever you cross that destination, then it's procedure that the pilot will inform you when you're flying over Kilimanjaro, which is the highest mountain in Africa and the second highest mountain in the world, 5,000 odd feet, etc. So as we flying over the mountain, the pilot makes an announcement on the PA system that if you look from your shutter, those that are sitting on the left side of the aircraft, you'll have a glimpse, and you'll able to see this huge high mountain, Kilimanjaro. And people have summited this and it's a big thing, etc., etc. And you have these hiking trails and the rest of it. And fate had it such that as I was flying over the mountain, lo and behold, I was reciting the Quran at that time. And I was reflecting over the verse of Surah Al-Qalam or Surah Al-Noon in the 29 Juz, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. By the grace of your Lord, you are not insane. وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. And for you is unending reward. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And you are on the highest level of character. عَلَىٰ. So subhanAllah, we know there's nothing like coincidence. Everything is by the plan and the will of Allah. Here the pilot is talking of this high, raised, elevated mountain and summiting and reaching the zenith of this mountain and peaking this mountain. And at the same time, at the same time, I was fortunate enough to read the verse in which Allah speaks about the pinnacle of character and the height of nobility and reaching that real height. This is a physical height, this is a spiritual height. This anyone can climb. This is those who have been blessed and favored with great character. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, in the context of the ayah, in the verses preceding this verse where Allah says that you were, on that highest level of nobility and character, Allah refutes the allegation of insanity from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which the infidels had leveled against the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam to malign his nobility. They had wrongly attributed this, and Allah said it's baseless. This is hogwash. This is absurd. This is ludicrous. This is preposterous. How dare they accuse you of insanity? You are not insane, and you have the highest character. So the correlation between the two, rabt bayn al ayat, which is such an amazing science of the Quran, in that the scholars say that the ayah releases a hint. Kullama kana al-insanu ahsana khuluqan kana ab'ad min al-jununi. And it's mentioned in Bayan al-Quran that the more noble your character is, the further you are from insanity. وَيُلْزَمُ مِنْهُ أَنَّ سُوءَ الْأَخْلَاقِ قَرِيبٌ مِنَ الْجُنُونِ. And it also releases a hint that evil character and bad conduct is a type of insanity and naivety and foolishness, if you were to call it so. So the more evil your character is, the closer you are to insanity, and the more noble your character is, the further you are from insanity. Anyway, just on the topic of mountain in different contexts, etc. There's that narration when Allah created the mountains, the angel said, O my Lord, is there any creation of yours stronger than mountains? هَلْ فِي خَلْقِكَ شَيْءٌ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْجِبَالِ. And then Allah said, yes, steel. Steel is stronger than mountains. وَأَنْزَلْنَا الْحَدِيدَ فِيهِ بَأْسٌ شَدِيدٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. And then they said, O our Lord, is there anything stronger than steel? And Allah said, yes, fire. Fire. And then they asked, oh Allah, is there anything stronger than fire? And it continues, water. And is there anything stronger than water? Wind. Water. Wind can blow water, etc. And then they said, oh Allah, is there anything greater than all of this? And Allah said, yes. Ibn Adam, one action of man, تصدق بيمينه فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما تنفق يمينه. That when he spends and he gives charity and he does that secretly and discreetly, that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand, meaning he keeps it a secret, that is more wholesome and more great than everything. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he will say unto them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these mountains, فَقُلْ يَنْصِفُهَا رَبِّي نَصْفًا. So the eye of a believer, here's a quick reflection. A believer will see these amazing mountains. He will even do a trail on it. He will even do a hike on it. He will even admire these mountains. But he'll also remind himself that when the time comes, then the hour of Qiyamah comes, then my Lord will reduce this to smithereens. So Dhul-Qarnayn, when he erected this defensive wall, he said to that nation that was living there, he said, they will not be able to scale it. فَمَسْطَاعُوا أَن يَظَهَرُوهُ وَمَسْطَطَاعُوا لَهُ نَقْبًا. I've created such a strong defensive wall that this nation, Yajuj and Majuj, will not able to scale it nor penetrate it. But then he said, فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا. When the decree of my Lord comes before Qiyamah, then as mighty and as strong as this wall is, he'll reduce it to dust. He'll reduce it to dust. So Allah says, the sky is so strong, it's so solid. But before Qiyamah, فَيَوْمَئِذٍ وَاهِيَا وَاهِيَا. In Surah Al-Haqq, Allah says, on that day it will be weak and feeble. Why? Because Allah has now decided to dismantle the entire universe. In fact, in the seven Juz in Surah An'am, oh man, this ayah, well, every ayah just blows me away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ. And it is Allah who has, authority and dominance and control over His bondsmen and creation. وَيُرْسِلُ عَلَيْكُمْ حَفَظًا وَيُرْسِلُ عَلَيْكُمْ حَفَظًا. And He sends angels for your protection. He sends angels for your protection. In the 13 Juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in Surah Al-Ra'd as well. لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِن خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Yamin is in the meaning of ba, يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. So Allah says he sends angels, and these angels rotate and they protect you. And Ka'b Ahbar's call is mentioned there in the tafaseer, that if it was not for the intervention of these angels around us, then the jinnat and the other creatures would have made our life a living misery. So the angels protect us. And how often you see a child, he's running or she's running and he's going to slip or he's going to hurt himself, and oops, and just in the nick of time, somebody comes out or he diverts or she moves away, and then you see the divine help of the Almighty. They cross him over a road, and just if they were 1 minute earlier or 1 minute later, it could be fatal. It could be, serious, and it could be catastrophic. But exactly how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected them. The question then arises, if the angels are there in their protection, then how is it that occasionally they still get hurt or humans still get injured, etc.? And the answer is given in the ayah, يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. That these angels protect us by the will of Allah. And when the will of Allah is to move back and to allow fate to take its course, then fate and destiny takes its course, and then occasionally we get hurt or injured or bruised, etc. Anyway, coming back to that ayat of the seven Jews of Surah Al-An'am, Allah says, وَيُرْسِلُ عَلَيْكُمْ حَفَظًا, that Allah has sent angels for your protection. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ تَوَفَّتْهُ رُسُلُنَا وَهُمْ لَا يُفَرِّطُونَ. My word. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ, when death approaches one of you, تَوَفَّتْهُ رُسُلُنَا, our angels and envoys and messengers, cause him to pass on. وَهُمْ لَا يُفَرِّطُونَ, and they do not fall short in the execution of their duty. It's mentioned there in the tafsir, in Bayanul Quran, that the very angels that are delegated to protect man, when the time of his existence on earth expires, now they change their role from protection to assisting the angel of death in inducing the death upon that person. So the very angels that till yesterday were to safeguard you, protect you, insulate you, buffer you, rescue you, cushion you, that you don't get hurt, you don't fall, that very angels now change their role now to create, to bring about the death that Allah has decreed upon you. Why? Because now Allah has decided that your time on earth is over. So the angel whose role yesterday was to rescue you, now that same angel's role is to be part of the overall mission to see how your soul is removed. تَوَفَّتْهُ رُسُلُنَا. So this mountain, as huge as it is, and as a peg as it is, and as it holds the earth, but Allah says on the day of Qiyamah, or prior to Qiyamah, it will be reduced to dust. فَيَذَرُهَا قَاعًا صَفْصَفًا. And that's verse 106, leaving the earth as a barren and completely leveled plain. يَذَرُهَا يَتْرُكُهَا قَاعًا. It will be a leveled plain, soft safa, completely even. And then Allah emphasizes that in the next verse again, 107, لا ترى فيها عوجا ولا أمتا. There will be no curve in the earth, there will be no elevation in the earth. There will be no depression, there will be no protrusion. It will be completely leveled out. In the 13 Juz in Surah Al-Ra'd, Allah says, يوم تبدل الأرض غير الأرض والسماوات وبرزوا لله الواحد القهار. The earth will be turned into a different earth, and so will the sky. And everyone, barazu, dhaharu, will appear before Allah. So it will be a completely leveled ground, and then hisab and accountability will take place. وَكَفَى بِنَا حَاسِبِينَ. And Allah says, my knowledge is adequate to take hisab. My knowledge is adequate to take hisab. And I grapple, right? You know how often, and probably many men will relate with this here, you go to the marketplace or you go to the mall, and then you like made a mental note of what your wife told you to buy. And when you get into the aisle, and now you, okay, today you do a video call and just show her the object or the item. And then she's like, no, not this one or that one or whatever it is. And I can just imagine how many men will be laughing listening to this, because it happens to me and it happens to everyone. But like 10 minutes ago, you left home and you made a mental note and you got there and you forgot. And this is how short-lived our memory is. This is how short-lived. And sometimes the kids ask you three things or four things, and you get there, now which child wanted what thing, and you scratch in your head. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge is completely encompassing. Completely. Allah's knowledge is adequate for hisab. These files, these records, these journals, this is just there to present it to man so that he can read it and peruse through it, and all the details are captured there. But in no way is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in need of any record. Bala wa rusuluna ladayhim yaktubun. The angels are recording it. Otherwise, Allah's knowledge is sufficient. Allah's knowledge is sufficient. In verse 108, Allah says, يَوْمَ إِذِي يَتَّبِعُونَ الدَّاعِيَ لَا عِوَجَ لَهُ وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ. My word. On that day, that is the day of Qiyamah, the people will rise from their graves and they will follow the caller towards, they will follow the caller towards the plane of resurrection. So one announcer, that is the angel, will announce, أَيَّتُهَا الْعِظَامُ الْبَالِيَةُ. Right, this is what the scholars mentioned, that the scattered bones, the decomposed bones, the flesh that is, you know, across the cemeteries of the world, stand up. It's time for hisab. And yes, the bone and the flesh and the anatomy and the human and will all just fit into place. The famous incident in the Quran, regarding Sayyidina Uzair alayhi salam, أو كالذي مر على قرية, or like the person who passed a village, وهي خاوية على عروشها, أي وهي ساقطة على عروشها, and it had collapsed on its roofs. قال أن يحيي هذه الله بعد موتها. And he said, I'm just wondering in which manner will Allah give life and revive everything. Yeah, not will, that's a Nabi, he has absolute yaqeen and conviction. In which manner will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give resurrection and revive everything. Sayyidina Maryam radiyallahu anha said, أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي غُلَامٌ. But how am I going to have a child? وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ وَلَمْ أَكُ بَغِيَّا. There's two ways of conception. Legal, illegal. Lawful, unlawful. Legitimate, illegitimate. I'm free from both. I'm not wedded and I haven't committed an act of immorality. لَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ. No male has touched me. وَلَمْ أَكُ بَغِيَّا. And I am not immoral. قَالَ كَذَلِكَ, the angel said, exactly, you will remain like this, pure, chaste, wholesome, modest, bashful, unmarried. قَالَ رَبُّكِ هُوَ عَلَيَّ هَيِّنَ. And for Allah it is easy. The sheer intention of Allah is existence, the sheer intention. Many people have this notion that Allah just has to say kun. That's wrong. Allah doesn't have to say anything. That's an expression of the fact that iradatullahi huwa al-wujud. It's not like, you know what, on a switch and everything starts and Allah has to say kun. No. This is an expression, innama amruhu idha arada shay'an ay yaqul, that if he intends anything, he merely says be and so will it be. Otherwise, the sheer intention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wujud. So, O Maryam, you will remain like this and you will conceive and a child will be born. يَوْمَ إِذِي يَتَّبِعُونَ الدَّاعِيَةَ. So, one announcer will announce and everyone will stand. Uzair alayhi salam comes to this locality and he says, how will it happen? In which manner? فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ. Allah gave him death for 100 years. ثُمَّ بَعَثَ. Then Allah revived him. قَالَ كَمْ لَبِثْتُ. How long did you sleep? لَبِثْتُ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ. Probably half a day or one day. So one is Allah made him sleep for a century and then Allah made it appear to him that it was half a day. قَالَ بَلْ لَبِثْتَ مِئَةَ عَامٍ فَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِكَ وَشَرَابِكَ. Look at your food and your drink. لَمْ يَتَسَنَّ. It has not, it's not rotten. It's not gone off. 100 years and it's not gone off. لا إله إلا الله. This is a verse of the Quran. لَمْ يَتَسَنَّ. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ. And look at your mule and donkey. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ وَلِنَجْعَلَكَ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ الْعِظَامِ كَيْفَ نُنْشِزُهَا ثُمَّ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا. Now look at this donkey that had died on and had, you know, collapsed there. How are we going to gather it and assemble it and put flesh over the bones again? And then Allah revived it. فَلَمَّا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ قَالَ أَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. So an announcer will announce and come forward. لَا عِوَجَ لَهُ. They will be without any deviation or evasion. That when this announcer will announce, nobody will able to camouflage, avoid, or disappear. You know how often there's an announcement and somebody, he takes shelter elsewhere, or he stealthily sneaks out, or he discreetly moves himself away. You know, in your student days, when somebody would come and you were called into, the office, or into the area where studies would take place, etc. And suddenly somebody, you know, tries to make his way out, or he just avoids the being summoned by the authorities. And these are things that happen in the world all the time. But on that day when the announcer will announce, he's like, no, I'm not coming out of my grave. No, I'm staying here. I'm coming out and I'm going to avoid. No, la iwaja la. You know, sometimes like, no, I'm just going to say I didn't hear. The voice wasn't clear. I don't know what you were saying. Sorry. So I've got a valid excuse. You know what? I didn't hear. In no regard, in no way will there be any way to avoid or to evade or to deviate from the call of this caller, or in any way to avoid the responding to this call. وخشعت الأصوات وخشعت الأصوات للرحمن. Voices will be lowered before Ar-Rahman. Billions will converge on what we call mahshar. Mahshar is ismu dharf. The plains of resurrection. The plains of resurrection. One of the names of the day of Qiyamah is Yawmul Jam'i, the day of assembly. وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتِ. You just have a classroom full of kids, or a hall full of kids, or few families, and then, you know what, it's noisy, it's rowdy, you can barely hear yourself, you're trying to get people to tone down, you're screaming at your optimum level, and you need to amplify yourself. Billions, but the panic. إِنَّكُمْ مَحْشُورُونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حُفَاتًا عُرَاتًا غُرْلًا. You will stand up on the day of Qiyamah barefoot, حُفَاتًا عُرَاتًا nude, غُرْلًا uncircumcised. As the Quran says that you will return to us كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةً, as we created you the first time. And our mother Aisha radiallahu anha said, oh, what a disgrace, what a disgrace that people's bodies would be exposed and nude. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the moment will be so intense, so intense that a person won't able to look at himself, leave alone anywhere else. The moment will be so intense. Allah forbid you going to an accident scene in which there are corpses and bodies lying, and there are choppers that are hovering over, and there are emergency vehicles and sirens that are being sounded. The panic, the stress, the anxiety, the identification of the bodies, etc. You cannot look right or left. You're not conscious of yourself, oblivious of your surroundings. And this is one small issue in the world without trivializing it. Can you imagine that supreme horror? وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ. And the voices will just be dropped and they will be lowered. فَلَا تَسْمَعُ إِلَّا هَمْسَا. You will hear nothing but footsteps. You will hear nothing but footsteps. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَاتَّقُوا النَّارِ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمَرَى. Fear the blazing flames of hell, even if it means by giving a date in charity. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَبِكَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبًا. And if that's not possible, then rescue your soul from that flame by saying a kind word. May Allah grant us the ability and save us from the eternal doom and destruction of Jahannam. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Wa salli Allahumma wa sallim ala Nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.